Whenever a government is behind a sector in such a big way, that really bodes well for the companies that are operating in the sector. So in this case, Intel obviously is trying to catch up to TSMC, whose capex...
That's the Taiwan Semiconductor.
Taiwan Semiconductors. Okay. Their capex is north of $40 billion annually. Just to put it in context. TSMC's.
Okay.
And so that's what we are talking about in terms of what it takes to manufacture these leading node chips. I mean,
ooh, that's a lot more than Intel, which is like 25.
And all these hyperscalers, I mean, look at their capex. They're spending north of $30 billion, whether it's Google, Meta, Amazon. I mean, so the point being, like, $20 billion in that context doesn't seem that big, you know, when you compare them to compare it to the capex of these companies. At the same time, I think it's a nice way for Intel to really move forward with their ambitions on the manufacturing side. We know they have been behind, and because of the government support, they can keep investing. And I think that second step would be to get one of the fabless companies to really partner with Intel in terms of using that capacity that will come online. So whether it's NVIDIA, whether it's Qualcomm, whether it's Apple, question is, will they be using this capacity that Intel will bring online over
the
course of...
Why wouldn't they use it?
They should, but right now the choke point is TSMC. All of NVIDIA's GPUs are made by TSMC. If something
happens... Is that right?
Yes. So, and that's the thing that I think from a sovereign perspective, you want to alleviate that choke point.
No wonder our Navy's all over the South China Sea. I mean, holy... I didn't know it was that...
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
No, but you know what? Earlier in the break, Paul and I were talking about Apple, and we were also talking about it on air.
Yep.
And Paul makes the point that Tim Cook's turning up in China because, as a U.S. company dependent on China, they've got that. He's got to preserve those links there. So now let's go back to the point you were making about getting domestic use of all these new chips that are going to be potentially produced in the United States. What's going to be the argument to get somebody like an NVIDIA to switch when they've already quite happy with what they've got? They've got to like the new product. I mean, because they've got bigger fish to fry.
Well, they are right now supply constrained. If they were making more GPUs, they will be able to sell it. So the constraint right now is the manufacturing capacity. So I don't think NVIDIA would mind, as long as they get the same yields and same quality of chips manufactured onshore. And from a fabless company perspective, whether it's Apple or NVIDIA, you want diversification. Given all the geopolitical tensions, you don't want all your eggs to be in one basket, especially when it comes to manufacturing your product.
All right, let's flip the switch here. The U.S. weighs sanctioning Huawei's secretive Chinese chip network. I mean, you and I have been talking about this for a few years here, about what seems to be a technology cold war between China and the West. This seems like a big deal, U.S. weighing sanctions on Huawei, one of the big players.
Well, Huawei was always restricted for a very long time. Yep. What was happening was they had a lot of affiliate entities that were able to do business when it comes to procuring the parts or the tools. And when I think everyone saw that Huawei made a phone with a 5-nanometer node, that just caught everyone off guard. And people were questioning, how did they get the technology and the components to make that phone? And I think that is the genesis of some of these newer restrictions. But right now we are in that point in generative AI way where everyone is talking about on-device AI, and what Huawei is really aiming to build is that next generation of smartphone where you can have on-device AI. Even Apple is doing that. Every smartphone maker's PC maker is doing that, and that's why these restrictions are very important.
All right, let me just go to jumping in here. You know, if I'm Apple at this developer conference, and by the way, Ed from San Francisco just pings me, say he's listening, is Apple CarPlay, good for Ed. I didn't know he was so technologically advanced. So Mandeep, what's gonna happen? What can Apple do at this developer conference in June? Like, if I'm an Apple investor, this is big for me. I need to see something.
I mean, look at what NVIDIA has done on the data center side. Right now, you have a huge greenfield opportunity on the device side. Whether it's your PC, your smartphone, your TV, there will be a lot of on-device AI across all these mature markets, which is going to drive a huge refresh cycle. So from an Apple perspective, the only way they keep their share and the dominance they have had on the premium tier is by rolling out AI, which is why they are likely partnering with Google. I mean, nobody would have imagined that happening. So,
yeah, well, I guess to go back to the sanctions that we're looking at with Huawei, this is targeting the supply chain.
Yeah.
But it's all triggered by this technological advance in its phone. So it looks like there's something loose, there's some hole in the system, because they were not meant to be seeing this kind of development coming out of Huawei. So do you think that the targets on the supply chain are going to actually work and be effective?
I mean, yes, that's why they keep adding more entities to the restricted list, is because, yeah, you can ban Huawei from doing business, but then there are all these affiliated entities that kind of feed into or deal with Huawei that are not restricted. So from a U.S. government perspective, if they really want to impose these sanctions, then they got to make sure the restricted entity list is much broader than just Huawei, and which is what they seem to be doing here.